We have looked at some of Sidney Fowler Wright's science fiction back in episode 26. However, he routinely wrote works of fantasy, his The Island of Captain Sparrow coming out in 1928. The novel begins with Charlton Foyle being cast out on a raft on sea due simply to the fact that the owners of the cruise ship he had been on began to shoot each other very vehemently, so that he felt the need to slip out in the boat which they had on standby to deliver some of their illicit goods. After he is nearly drowned, he finds himself within a small cave, a secret approach to an otherwise inaccessible island, but finds ancient rope rings in the wall that reveal someone else had used the cave as a landing place before. Making his way through the caves, he finds two things: an ancient, horrifying mural of a satyr, and a ship cannon manufactured in 1866. Wright then stops narrating Charlton's journey for a moment, and tells the story of how the pirate Captain Sparrow came to the island, found the humanoid satyr race inhabiting it, and ways to cook them just right, and made a tentative peace with the human inhabitants of the island, a peace on the surface only, as the diseases brought to the island by the pirates, and assorted port scum making up Sparrow's crew, start to kill them off. Sparrow leaves the island, never to return again, leaving his son Jacob to eventually be in charge of the brutal pirate stock he left behind, which in time began to interbreed with the satyrs when not engaged in eating them. This is an interesting narrative, but it is brought out a bit too early, long before we see Jacob or any of the islanders, and before we even see any of the satyrs in the present. It seems Wright did this because he may not have found any other way to include the history of the island, but it is a bit clunky nonetheless. Charlton makes his way from the caves, and is almost killed by a satyr because he tries to warn a wandering nude woman that the satyr had wished to spring upon her with unfriendly designs. When the woman finds him later, injured in a thicket, she explains of her own arrival on the island a few years prior, the death of her comrades, her subsequent hiding in the trees for several years, avoiding the people on the island and pretending to have died in the swamps, and of her refusal to marry the part satyr son of Jacob Sparrow, the mad Demers, who loves nothing more than to hunt satyrs in the forest, cutting and stabbing them to death, and beating his wives. The two, of course, fall in love, despite Charlton only seeing Marcel's back in the moonlight initially. She, for her part, goes to try and find clothes, to meet him properly later on, gets captured, and is at the mercy of Jacob, who intends to have her wedded to his son, even if she has to be beaten into submission. Meanwhile, Charlton sees the horrid spectacle of the satyr hunt, while having to find a way to rescue Marcel from the Union in order to thwart the designs of Jacob, old and half blind but cruel and manipulative, and also in order to fulfill the prophecy of the Priest of Gear, the leader of the surviving island natives. The characters who matter are sufficiently developed for the story to work, though Jacob does not show up for some time after being introduced, and he doesn't really show up as much as he could. The conflict with Demers could also stand to be a bit longer, as he seems to barely show up outside of the satyr hunt. The other islanders are mostly just one amorphous mass, which means the island, as a setting, is not as developed as it should be. The relationship between Marcel and Charlton is a little simplistic in its staging, but at least Marcel is quite headstrong and likes to disagree with Charlton on occasion. Overall, a fine adventure read, though the native island culture and its antiquity are hinted at, but are never really explored.